It's mid-November, and I told myself that I wasn't going to update the calendar on my door until after I did my October book review update. So this is the obligatory changing of the guard because I'm finally sitting down to record this episode of What Did I Read Last Month? In the recap for September, I mentioned that I don't think it's realistic for a person to have the expectation that they're going to be reading 5 or more books every month. And then October happened, and it could not have been closer to reality that 5 books was just out of the question for me. For a lot of people, the changing of the seasons are kind of emotionally tumultuous, and I had kind of a tough October. I started 3 books and I finished 2 books. I read Lean In, which I was reading in September, and I finished it in October. I started a book called Some of Us, and then I read a children's book called Son of a Gun. I'm going to be going over Lean In and Son of a Gun a little bit, and then also explaining why I only read 2.5 books. I'm refilming this because I think I can do better, and frankly, I think you guys deserve better than what I had previously recorded. So that's why it's even further days delayed from the mid-November dates that I was talking about previously, just, a minute ago. So I finished 2 books, and in the previous version of this video, I had like a little rant about how I don't think it's fair that we hold ourselves up to this expectation to read like a dozen books a month. I think that there's a certain incentive for some influencers to claim that they are reading more books than they actually read. Reading is kind of a broad phrase, and you can just kind of partially read something, not really pay attention, not take it in, skim pages, and it still counts as reading. And if you claim that you read it, it helps your ranking in the algorithm to claim that you've read a lot of books because suddenly you have a lot more rich keywords. Also, I don't want to sound like sour grapes here. I'm sure there are people who do read a dozen books a month. I also think that it's entirely possible that it's overrepresented in BookTube, and I just want to give you guys the permission to get yourself off the hook and not hold yourself up to that standard because it's impossible to know whether or not everybody who claims that they're reading every book is actually reading every book. So I give you permission to be skeptical of those people and also be gentle on yourself. That being said, I think it's totally normal, totally fine to have time in your life where your hobbies kind of fall off. And at the changing of the seasons, that's kind of a place where a lot of people struggle. I'm seeing this a lot on my social media, just my close friends on Instagram stories or whatever, talking about how they're having kind of a rough go of it. And that's pretty normal for this time of year. Like, the earth is dying, right? We're seeing Persephone returned to the underworld. And that manifestation of the passage of time really affects a lot of people, especially if you've experienced some sort of trauma in your life, because it just kind of is a sudden reminder that, oh yeah, that's right, it's been more time now. So what I'm trying to say is, if you kind of fell off the wagon with the unavoidable passage of time marker that is the changing of the seasons in a place where the seasons change, like in fall and spring in the Midwest, if you're very far from the equator, you see the passage of time in the seasons, and if that affects you, you're in good company. It affects a lot of people. I think that that, coupled with a dramatic changing in my routine, kind of put me in a place where I wasn't reading as much. In the beginning of October, I ran a half marathon, and in training for that half marathon, I was running, for like over an hour, like most days while training. And I was listening to a lot of audiobooks coupled with getting to bed early and reading books before bed. And then at the beginning of October, when I had that half marathon, suddenly that went away. And it was coupled with a work trip. That work trip really changed my habits and made it harder to take that time and read. So that's kind of why I fell off the reading wagon. The first book that I finished in October was Lean In by Sheryl Sandberg. And there's a lot of drama going on with Facebook in October, so I was pretty pleased to finish it. I listened to it on audiobook and I finished it when I was running the half marathon. There are no positive attributes to this book that are unique to this book. If you want career advice and you're trying to start a career and you don't have like a network of friends, parents to set you up with jobs, then don't read this book. Like honestly, if you are a recent college grad or you're going to be graduating college soon and you would like to start a career and you don't have very much networking within your personal group, you know, maybe your parents didn't go to college, don't read this book. Read Machiavelli for Women. This book is useless to you. Like I said, there is no good career advice that is unique to this book that other books don't have. And if anything, this book is very victim blamey. I would say that if I were in charge of marketing this book, I would market it to managers. I think the people that have the most to gain functionally from reading this are managers. And the reason why I came about this is I was like, who would I want to read this book? And I would want any person who's ever managed me in the workplace to read this book. But for me, Cheryl talks about how her grandma went to college, about how her mother went to college. Neither of my parents have bachelor's degrees. There are stories in this book about how one of Cheryl's friends calls her up and is just like, I'm willing to take a title decrease and a pay cut. If you'll give me a job, I will solve any problem you have. And I'm just like, Cheryl, that's great, but I could literally never do that in my entire life. This isn't an option to me to just take a pay cut. Like, I have a mortgage. You know, like, it doesn't. It's not good advice, and it's also very victim blamey. There's this part where she talks about how women should not feel intimidated to take on male mentors just because of how other people interpret it, while completely ignoring the fact that women tend to not take on male mentors because of how the male mentor may interpret it. I don't care what my coworkers think. I don't want this dude to think I'm hitting on him. Super victim blamey. I would love to do a dedicated video just about it. I think that altogether is incredibly tone deaf. All of the criticisms that I had heard about the book kind of were true and accurate. I got it from the library for the purpose of just finding the specific pages with stories on it, and it kind of reaffirmed my belief that there's not much of a difference between listening on an audiobook and reading a physical book if you're consuming the content in a similar way. I know that there are people who like to just have stuff on in the background to fill in the silence of their life, but I'm not one of those people. I don't like passively watch or consume content. I like silence. When something is on, I have to be paying attention to it. I do inhale a lot of podcasts when I'm doing like data entry, but I don't do data entry anymore, first of all. And then second of all, if I'm not actively paying attention to audio stimulants, then it annoys me. I cannot just have noise on in the background. I'd rather work in complete silence than have noise on in the background. The next book that I attempted was The Some of Us by Heather McGee. So I started reading this on an airplane, and I, for some reason, just wasn't feeling incredibly compelled by it. I had several layovers, and instead of reading it, I literally did anything else. It's a very interesting book. The basic concept, I read about half of it, is that equality is not a zero-sum game. Racial equality is not a zero-sum game. That means that in order to make things more equal for everybody, it does not require making things less equal for white people. You don't have to compromise some people's freedoms in order to give other people more freedom, or you could exchange that for rights. You don't have to take away in order to give to others, and that in fact, giving rights to everybody actually helps everyone. If you go out of your way to make things more equal for one group, it ends up helping a larger group. And when you go out of your way to hurt the rights of one group, it ends up hurting everyone. It's a very interesting read. It opened my eyes to a lot of things. I was on the wait list for this book for months from the library, and when I wasn't reading it the way that I thought I would, when I was not compelled to read this book, I decided it was better for me to put it back into the library system because I know other people really wanted to read it. It's a critically acclaimed book, but it just wasn't compelling for me. I don't know if I was just going through a weird time and I just wasn't interested in reading, but honestly, I could not get through the book. I thought it was very interesting. I learned a lot. It was a lot that I knew, but then there was a bunch that I didn't know that I came across. I got halfway through when I realized I wasn't going to be completing it within my book reservation timeline from the library, and that I would be doing better for everyone if I sent it back to the library, and that I checked it out at a later date if I felt it calling to me again. So around mid-October, I got a little panicky because I was like, I'm not finishing this book. What am I going to do? And I already had this idea in my mind that I would like to read every book on my bookshelf. I mainly only have books that I've read before, but there are some books on my shelf that I've never completely read or I haven't read in years. And I've decided it would be really nice to read every book on my bookshelf. And there's this one book, Son of a Gun by Ann DeGraff. She was a professor of mine in college. And it's a short book, it's tiny. It's a children's book that I had never read. And whenever I find myself like really backed into a corner panicking, I'm like, okay, like the goal is to read a book by the end of the month. How can I do that? And how can I do that without killing myself and like putting myself through a lot of drama and trauma to get it to happen? And so I was like, okay, we're gonna go to the literal littlest book, and that's the book we're gonna read. We're gonna start with that book. So children's book about Liberia, about child soldiers in Liberia. Yes, it's by a white woman, and the irony is not lost on me that I could not finish a literal book by a black woman about racial inequality, but a children's book about child soldiers written by a white woman, I was able to read. And what I would like to point out is just that children's books are just written a lot differently than adults' books. And this book, it is kind of a little challenging. I would say probably it's probably at least a sixth grader reading level. And I don't think it would have been compelling to me as a child. It's like, it's very dark. And it's like on topics that wouldn't appeal to me as a child. Like when I was in sixth grade, I was reading the unabridged Three Musketeers for like no reason. And I think I probably could have benefited in a lot of ways if I would have read age-appropriate books, because I think they would have stimulated my empathy in ways that reading adult literature isn't necessarily catered to do. I have no shame in reading books for children as an adult, because I really enjoyed, there's a phrase by Maurice Sendak that he just wrote books and somebody decided that they were for children. I think that children are people and that they are capable of complex thought and emotions, and there's nothing wrong with reading books that are intended for children as an adult. I mean, people read the Bible like a million times in their life, starting when they're a child, and they're continuously able to glean new meaning from that literature. You can read stuff over and over, you could read stuff meant for kids, and whether or not you're gonna get something new from it is really up to you. So anyway, so I read this, it's a pretty dark book. The most meaningful part about this book is the fact that it was like from my teacher, and I really liked her. I enjoyed hearing about her process in writing the book and the research that she did. Like, that to me is pretty encouraging, and reading it, it feels pretty authentic, and it lines up with other things that I've read about Liberian child soldiers, and it's pretty informative and educational. At the end of the day, the thing that I most enjoy about it is that I read it and it was written by somebody who I really respected. There's a small portion of my bookshelf that is dedicated to books written by people who I know, and that to me is just like really meaningful and part of the reason why I really enjoyed this book. So let's just do a quick look at my reading statistics to see where I'm at. So this year, in 2021, I was trying to do a schema where for every 3 books read by a woman, I would read 1 book read by a man. This is just simply to expose myself more to literature written by women, because in my experience, just by indexing author, gender, or sex, I tend to read more books written by men. And by the way, it is based off of gender identity, so if I were to read a book by a trans woman, that is a book written by a woman in my record keeping. Only mentioning that because I strongly believe that that is worth mentioning and important to mention, because I do read trans authors. In October of 2021, I finished 2 books. I do not count books that I partially completed. So only the 2, and they are both written by women, and altogether it was 342 pages. Right now, I'm sitting at 13 books written by women and 5 written by men this year. Pretty good numbers. I'm feeling pretty good about that. And that also means that the ratio is good, and I am actually able to read another book by a man if I so wanted. It just is that I'm currently reading a book by a woman. I try not to get too caught up on whether or not I can because you could always catch up later. It's not really something that should keep me from reading a book, but instead more so make me conscious of if there is an equally well-reviewed book written by women, maybe give that a try instead of reading a book by a man. So that's just that whole piece of information. Hopefully I'll get November to you guys in a little bit more timely of a manner. However, it's not that untimely. It's still the month after. So I you know what? This is all a success. Everything worked. No reason to be panicked about a singular thing. Thank you guys so much for watching. I know that this is a little bloggy, but this is a kind of a glimpse into what I'm like besides just the pet sim stuff. So I hope you enjoyed it. All right. Bye.